Call our PSTA meeting to order this morning of April 27th, 2016. Would our Vice Chair and Mayor Bujalski please lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance and we'll all rise.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, and we will go right into our public comment. I have several cards here, and just a reminder to folks who are in the audience who are here to talk about electric buses, now is the time to speak. When the sustainability discussion comes up later in the agenda, it's an informational item, so there's not the opportunity to do public speaking at that point. So if you're here to talk about electric buses, be sure and get a green card, and your opportunity to speak is now. So our first speaker is Phil Compton. Hi, Phil, you have 3 minutes.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, Bill Compton, senior organizing representative, Sierra Club, 1990 Central Avenue, St. Petersburg. I want to thank the staff for the display that they created last Wednesday in the parking lot, showing the contribution to curbing congestion and curbing pollution that transit provides. I thought that was a brilliant effort. I also appreciate the accuracy with which they showed with boxes of dirt, the amount of pollution that is put out by all of us driving our cars, 50 cars, right? And then a diesel hybrid bus, and then the electric bus that Proterra provided. And thank you for including the Proterra electric bus in that. The small amount of dirt that was displayed there represented the 650 grams of carbon put out per mile versus 2,300 for diesel hybrid, 2,800 for a CNG bus, or 3,000 for a diesel bus. And that's due to the fact that Duke and other utilities, of course, are still burning coal and natural gas. That will decline. I want you to know also that the same day that University of South Florida had a demonstration at the Center for Urban Transportation Research, USF, has its own bull runner fleet of buses. They're old, they need to be replaced, and USF is looking seriously at replacing them with electric buses to serve the students on campus there. You know, there's some questions about electric buses. A lot of people think they cost more. They now cost about the same as the diesel hybrids that you're buying, that you've been buying the last few years. The other day, nations of the world got together and signed the accord that said that we're going to do all that we can to reduce our carbon emissions because, well, the future depends on that. Serious thing, you've been doing all you can do. But the good news is that the technology has come along that allows you to do significantly more. You can cut the emissions from your diesel hybrids by 72%, even with Duke burning coal and natural gas, if you include, start including zero emission electric buses. Of course, that number, that 650 grams I mentioned, that will decline as time goes on as we add more solar and more wind to our portfolio of electricity. Your friends across the bay, Hillsborough County, got an F from the American Lung Association, once again, for having the worst air quality. That's not just a Hillsborough County problem. They had another smoggy day yesterday. It was unhealthy. It was not a good day to be outside walking. And that smog comes across the bay. You can do your part to keep people in Pinellas County healthy and keep the entire Bay Area healthy by moving to the new technology that greatly reduces your emissions while not raising the cost. In fact, it will save you hundreds of thousands of dollars over the life of the bus and fuel maintenance. So please look at that very carefully when you consider your next replacement buses. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Mr. Tom Rask. Mr. Rask, it looks like you have 6 minutes with combined time from Sully Grasso.
Okay. Good morning. Thank you. Tom Rask, Unincorporated Pinellas County. Let's talk about reality as it is today. Mr. Compton spoke here about electric buses. 92% of electricity produced in Florida comes from either carbon-based sources or nuclear, all of which the Sierra Club opposes. Continuing further in the vein of reality as it is today, I will read to you the PSTA operating statistics because no one else does. PSTA talks about ridership when it's up, so when they don't talk about it, you can be pretty sure it's down. Now, last month, there were no ridership statistics, and it simply said a detailed report will be forthcoming. I don't see that report in this month's agenda packet, so therefore I don't know what the January ridership was. But I do know what the February ridership was. Total bus revenue passenger trips down 7%. That's year to date, down for the month, down through the first 5 months of your fiscal year. Other bus passenger trips, including East Lake Looper, which I previously opposed, down 21%. Looper trolley passenger trips, which I also spoke out against, down 9.3% of your fiscal year. Jolly trolley passenger trips, Jolly trolley that we hear is so wonderful, down 23% for the fiscal year. That's the reality. Now, I sent you an email. I hope you read it well ahead of the meeting. I said I'd come and talk about this. At your last meeting, the consent agenda was not approved. If you watched the 30-second video, there was no motion to approve the consent agenda. Mr. Beavis had off the chair, Ms. Rice, when she said, do I hear a motion too? And he said, so moved. What was moved? You're going to be asked today to approve meeting minutes which say that there was a motion to approve. When I brought this up, your general counsel, Mr. Zimmet, wrote, on the consent agenda, the board has only two options. Remove for discussion or approve the agenda items on consent. Did you know that? It's not in your board rules or regulations. It's not in any statute. If one of you simply wanted to vote no on a consent agenda item, Mr. Zimmet would have you believe that you have to remove it and perhaps face a hostile board, as Mr. Roche did here a few years ago. Sometimes, if you're in the minority, if you're the sole dissenting voice, you choose to just vote no. You don't want to pull anything for discussion. You just want to be on the record as voting no. Now, there are attorneys on this board, at least one, Mr. Diamond, and it should trouble him, at least, that when I asked for authority for Mr. Zimmet's position, he provided none. I asked what was the motion. I also asked what was his authority specifically for this position that on consent agenda items, the board has only two options, either remove it for discussion or vote yes. He provided no authority. He also failed to say anything when the Sunshine Law violation came up. He sat right there, had nothing to say. He heard it, saw it, had nothing to say. That cost you guys over somewhere north of $2,000 in legal fees. So think about what you want to do going forward. You want to just do the reasonable thing and reapprove the consent agenda? Or do you want to you don't want to risk facing a lawsuit? If you watched the video, and I hope you have, there was so much consensus in the room here last month that you guys apparently forgot, or at least the chair forgot, because it is the chair's responsibility. The chair forgot that you actually need a properly formulated motion to vote on. This is basic. This is public meetings 101. Okay? And given the previous Sunshine Law violation by Ms. Rice, and there have been other ones not here by Ms. Rice, this should give you pause. So please pay attention, make sure the motion is properly formulated, because you can't count on your chair or general counsel to do it. Now, as far as the Attorney General opinion, the one and only that PSTA ever sought, I emailed you about that too. Mr. Zimmet sought this opinion on his own. Here's the letter from August 2014, undated, by the way. I'll leave a copy so you can look at it later. An undated letter. And I lay out the case for why it's clear that he saw it. Now, Mr. Miller would have you believe that he provided verbal authorization to do this. So we're expected to believe, we citizens, that this was not brought before the board. The one and only Attorney General opinion PSTA has ever sought was not sought with board approval, but with verbal approval from Mr. Miller. Okay, you can draw your own conclusions. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rask. And our next speaker is Walter Slubecki?
Slubecki.
Great. Hi, Walter.
Hi.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning, Mr. Miller. Good morning, members of the board.
Good morning.
My name is Walter Slubecki. I am a transit rider. Been using PSTA more since I moved to St. Pete in Tampa, and also transit advocate. I'm here today to first applaud PSTA for all that they have done in seriously considering battery electric buses. Technology's gotten better, as Mr. Compton had mentioned, and I really believe that you all are moving in the right direction. But I'm also here to say that cannot give up on what has already been accomplished. There's still a lot of work to be done. I know that there was a lot of doubt at this time last year about whether electric buses were even the way to go. A lot of that doubt has turned into confidence, but I know that there are still some people in the agency who have concerns. And for those who are still concerned about whether battery electric buses are the way to go for PSTA, I ask you to please consider the following. As Mr. Compton mentioned, the cost of these electric buses have gone down. They're now around the same cost that the Gili hybrids cost now. Also, the infrastructure to setting up the infrastructure, such as the charging stations, that is definitely doable. It's cost effective. And the battery technology itself is getting better, so that allows for longer distances under one charge. In the long run, battery electric buses are going to deliver so many benefits on cost, operations, maintenance, and environmental sustainability. And so much so that it will no longer be worth the time or resources to even look back at straight diesel buses. I ask every member of the PST board and the PST leadership team to continue the journey towards an environmentally sustainable future that includes battery electric buses. I do understand that that you all had applied for a grant, waiting word on that this summer, as far as whether you will get it. I do hope that you all do. That way that you all can continue in the direction that is right for our future and a cleaner environment. Just one last thing to note that, you know, I understand that bus ridership is down, but I think that's across the nation. I think two reasons is key, because number one, gas prices have gone down. That typically takes away choice riders. But also, big autos pushing millennials like myself towards gas-guzzling SUVs again. So that's definitely two more things to consider. Thank you so much for your time and attention.
Thanks, Walter. Our next speaker is Linda Munchak. Good morning,
everyone. My name is Linda Munchak. I'm a member and volunteer with the Sierra Club and a lifelong environmentalist. I've come to speak on behalf of sustainability and the reasons for and the motivations for going with electric. In 2000, former Vice President Al Gore showed the undesirable intrinsic link between atmospheric CO2 levels and global warming. Exxon scientists and the Koch brothers notwithstanding. The superstorms Katrina in 2005 and Sandy in 2012 in New Orleans and New York City respectively were sobering proof of the destructive power via flooding due to high tides or almost wind-driven wave action of both warmer, more energetic atmosphere and oceans. Therefore, both fossil and biofuels must be replaced by a much less carbon-emitting alternative fuel source, namely and specifically electricity. Electric buses reduce, in comparison to standard diesel buses, A, CO2 emissions by 78%, namely 3,000 grams per mile for the diesel buses versus 650 grams per mile for the electric. Maintenance costs have been reduced by 80%, $1 per mile for the diesel buses versus 20 cents per mile for the electric buses, evidenced by Proterra's electric buses, millions of driven passenger miles since 2010. And fuel costs have been reduced by 51%, $2.63 for the diesel buses versus $1.29 for the electric. Proterra electric buses offer the optimal combination of minor costs are $800,000 per bus, which is, as has been mentioned, on par with the hybrid buses now. Greater range in miles per charge, up to 258 miles, and a speedy recharge time of 5 to 10 minutes, up to an hour, which is considerably better than the alternatives. This can all be more easily accomplished by learning grant-winning lessons that Philadelphia used in obtaining their grants, which enable them to recently purchase 25 Proterra electric buses. Thank you very much for your time. Have a very good day.
Thank you. I have one more card. The last speaker is Tom Crumright. If there's anyone else who wants to speak, be sure to get your green cards up here. Hi, Tom.
Hi. Tom Crumright. I'm here as Vice President of Suncoast Electric Vehicle Association here in Pinellas County. And, you know, you guys have a great opportunity to join with the city of St. Petersburg in their quest to go 100% sustainable. And you can go green both ways, both economically, save the greenbacks, and help save the environment. And, you know, it's almost, even if I wasn't vice president, it's almost like a no-brainer. The costs up front have gotten to the point where they're on par even with the regular diesels, or even less possibly if you buy the bus and then lease the battery separately, pay for the battery lease out of your savings, so it's like getting it for free. This is a great opportunity to improve health situations. Diesel fumes are one of the top triggers for asthma attacks. So to me, it seems like all the way around, this is a great move. And I was there when the chair of Sierra Club, Michael Broom, was here to present the city of St. Petersburg with a multi-$100,000 grant, one of only four or five cities in the country to get this with a pledge of 100% sustainable. So it would really help in that effort tremendously by doing this. And these zero electric emission buses are just great. You know, most of you, I think, have had a chance to ride in one. They're quiet. You know, you can have discussions on them. You can do all kinds of things. They have Wi-Fi in them. And they're really definitely a bump up from, you know, the riding in the changing buses. So I'd really like to encourage you to go green, save the greenbacks, and save the planet too. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And it seems like all of our speakers today addressed the issue of the upcoming so I hope that you'll stick around today and hear our sustainability plan update. It'll be coming up soon on the agenda, and as always, we look forward to hearing feedback and insight from our constituents. Before we go to the agenda, just a couple of changes to make note of. We're going to eliminate items 3C, the MPO's Local Coordinating Board report, because there was not a meeting, and we're going to move up item 7C, the State Government Relations Consultant RFP discussion, led by our legislative chair, Ben Diamond. We're going to start with that report. And before we begin, Mr. Miller, would you like to introduce our state lobbyist?
Yes, I would. Good morning, everyone. I'm happy to introduce and welcome Chris Carmody from Gray Robinson. The board might recall that 2 months ago we received a report from our federal government affairs team led by Harry Glenn, and we scheduled this time at the end of the state legislative session to get a report on our state, our successful 2016 session. Following Chris's update on the completed session, then Ben Diamond, our legislative committee chair, who I understand loved our PSPA trip to Tallahassee so much that maybe he will end up staying there. He's going to discuss our April 6th meeting and then finish off talking about, as the chair just mentioned, the RFP process to renew our state team. So, Chris, welcome.
Good morning, Brad. Thanks for the kind introduction. And Ben, if we said anything that made you think it was going to be fun up there or it's really a part-time job, my apologies. I'll fall in that sort. As you said, Brad and board, we had a very successful session. We're proud to be a part of that with you. I'll go through them quickly. I know you guys have a long agenda, so we don't want to take up too much more of your time. I think first and foremost, the brainchild of this organization was a study on transportation disadvantage. As you all know, there's, I hate to use the word inequities because I know it's meant to be a fair allocation of that fund, but between rural and urban counties, it seems as if urban counties, especially like this one that has a strong transit system, tends to be penalized in how that allocation works, where we don't tend to get the right benefits. So working with the proper appropriations chairs and the stakeholders on this, we pushed forward a $200,000 study that would be commissioned by the Commission for Transportation Disadvantage that would take a look at that model and how it's allocated, how those funds are passed between urban and rural counties to make sure that it is a fair allocation working in the modern transportation system. I would call this a huge win, both in the short and the long term for PSTA and other similarly situated transit organizations across the state and urban areas. The funding model never seems to work well for us. While we appreciate the funds we get from the state and through that fund, it never seems to be a real win for organizations like ours. And this study, we hope, will shed some light on that and lead to a better funding model that will give PSTA the proper funding it needs for the long term. So we're excited about that. In July 1, when that funding goes into full effect, I'll be working closely with the commission there to make sure that the study goes in a way that all the facts that we need out there are out there. It should also be noted that the legislature fully funded the transit block grants, which PSTA obviously benefits from, over $400 million in that pot. So that's a good thing for us, and we obviously work with the stakeholders locally and across the state on that. Talk about the Tampa International and Clearwater Express route. Following the successful path we forged with the downtown St. Pete to Beaches bus rapid transit, and working with our local legislative leaders and with DOT, we're now in the process of moving forward on that to get funding from DOT and their various pots of money. As you recall, in the BRT route, we found that working with our local legislators and working with DOT, as opposed to some of the traditional funding models through legislature, actually worked out very well in that sense. So we're doing the same thing. Representative Chris Lapalle is leading that effort from a legislative front. We'll be staying in communication with him and his team to keep pushing that forward. So that's another thing that's moving forward. I probably should discuss a little bit. There have been merger discussions or efficiency discussions between HART and PSTA. Kudos to this board and to your leadership to be open-minded to all of those discussions. I know when legislators say, hey, we want to talk merger, that gives everyone a little pause because we like what we have here and it works in our funding model. But kudos to this board and to your leadership for being open to that idea and working with Chairman Lapalle has been one of the more outspoken proponents of having the discussion of mergers and efficiencies. And kudos to Brad working with HART and having those discussions. It's our expectation and having discussions with Chairman Lapalle that he'll have some sort of meetings this summer to further explore that idea. Although, as you know, the elections are coming in November, so no legislation or any kind of discussion at a Tallahassee level will happen until then. And of course, just a general session overview. You saw $82 billion budget, the largest in the state's history. The DOT's budget and transportation overall was funded at another high level, over $10 billion there. Very little vetoes from the governor's side as far as the budget goes, so that's a good thing. Legislators and them worked well to come up with that plan. But overall, things are going very well, and kudos again, the fly-in and such. Brad has, and this board and those of you taking part in the legislative process have really elevated PSTA's profile. As our team has been working with you, we've seen the transition from an organization that's well known locally with the local legislators, but didn't have a lot of branding, I guess, if you will, outside of this region. Whereas now you guys are considered leaders up in Tallahassee with other legislators that have any interest in transit. And I think that's a kudos to Brad and to this board of raising the profile, having not just, you know, the rhetoric of we need more funding or we need this, but actually having facts and solutions to some of the state's transportation issues. And with that, I'll take any questions you may have or get out of your way and let you guys continue with your meeting.
Any questions for Chris? And if not, we can, I'll hand the discussion off to our legislative chair, Ben Diamond.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just want to briefly summarize the legislative committee meeting, which took place on April 6th. We received much more in-depth report from our state government affairs team. We also had a very in-depth report from our federal affairs team and an excellent discussion by the committee on the issues that we're working on. We also discussed the status of our current procurement for a new lobbyist for our state government affairs work. The discussion really focused on, you know, making sure, as we've been discussing, that we time this correctly so that it doesn't interfere, and I think we have. We waited till after the session was over to issue the RFP, and the proposals are due in May. We also discussed, and Brad brought to the committee, a reference form so that board members have had the opportunity to work with various firms that submit a proposal, and a board member wants to provide input or feedback, they can do so by submitting that form to the selection committee. The Legislative Affairs Committee thought this was a process to allow some transparent input for board members who would like to give that input. But overall, we had a very good meeting. We definitely appreciate the work that our team is doing in Tallahassee and also in Washington. And I'll just add, you know, on a couple of these issues, on the Clearwater Bus, or Clearwater Beach Express issue, I think having the support of the entire Pinellas County delegation is going to be very helpful in showing the Florida Department of Transportation that there is broad community support for this project. And so we appreciate Representative Chris Latvala taking the lead on that, but there's going to be, we're hopeful we're going to have support from all corners of the county to work on that issue. So, and that's my report. Thank you.
Vice Chair.
I presume, and maybe Brad's the better person, I presume NPO is working with us on this too, or assisting us in lobbying efforts and all of that as well, because it is on their priority list.
It is, that's exactly right.
I'm following up on that, or just making sure they're doing their job. That's why I'm asking.
Thank you, and as Chair of our committee, Diamond, says, the idea is to show this broad-based legislative support, but the NPO is critical because the FDOT has told us that, yes, it's important that they do listen to their legislators, of course, but they also, they have to go through the process of the NPO support as well. And I know that this is one of the priorities. It's right to the beach access priority of the NPO, so they're doing it.
Well, obviously, let us know what we need to do to
just keeping it on radar.
Keep that.
Yeah.
Commissioner Johnson?
Thank you. I want to thank you, our lobbyists, for the time that they took and the excellent service that they gave us. That little $200,000 grant doesn't seem like a lot, but let me tell you that in the state of Florida, Pinellas County, PSTA, we transport people that are disadvantaged, either financially or mobility disadvantaged, over 1,000 people a day. And it doesn't stop on Saturday and Sunday. Try to give them some rest, but it's really important. And when they talk about how old our population is, seems like we have worked so hard on making us look youthful, we forgot about those people that built this county. They're still here. And some of us are getting older every day and remember how much we used to be able to do. Just some of us.
Oh,
I wasn't including anybody. But it's important. We have a tri-county, Julie, Commission on Transportation Disadvantaged, and they're part of the NPO, and they worked up some figures, and while we're doing, what was it, Brad, 2.5 million? Or
yeah.
Ross?
Yeah.
2.5 million trips a month? Hillsborough's only doing a little over 600,000. Pasco is doing not even close to that. We are doing the work. We need the money. Money is diverted to urban counties, rural counties, sorry, thank you, Ken, And we really have the people living here that need the services, so thank you again, 100 times, thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments? I have one quick question, Brad. This interaction feedback form, when will we see a final version, and when will that be distributed, and when do you get it back from the board?
So on my end, I believe the schedule is that the proposals from the firms are due on May 12th, so in a couple of weeks, we'll get the proposals, whoever turns in a proposal. We will fill out a form and send it to you electronically with the name of the firm on it, and it's really, it's up to you as a board member, if you have some experience with any of the firms that turn in a proposal, fill out the form at your choice. If you have experience with a firm and don't want to fill out the form, that's okay too. It's just a vehicle to getting input through this selection process from the board members who might have experience either in your city or as a state legislator, a former legislator or whatever, with the different firms that we're going to be. So May 12th, and then probably in the next couple of weeks, we'll set a due date for getting the forms back to us. This is going to come to the June PSTA meeting for final, go to the June legislative committee and then the board meeting in June.
Thank you. Thank you, Ben, for that report. Our next committee update report from Elaine Mann, our Transit Riders Advisory Committee.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Don't ask Elaine what the story is.
No, do not ask her. Broken toe, we'll go that far.
But it's a good story, it's a good story.
Thank you very much. Chairman Rice, Mr. Miller, esteemed board members, the Transit Riders Advisory Committee met on Tuesday, April 19th. The meeting opened with approval of minutes from the previous TRAC meeting. Immediately following, Cassandra Borchers, Chief Development Officer, provided an overview of the upcoming October 2016 system redesign. After detailed study, various routes are being changed to better service the needs of our community. This third phase of the redesign focuses on applying budget and system efficiencies, allowing for improvements in service time and coverage throughout the county. Staff is currently seeking and incorporating feedback internally from drivers, supervisors, and CSRs, as well as from city and county staffs. Public workshops, together with web and social media provisions, will be extended to obtain public contribution. The Transit Riders Advisory Committee will be kept apprised for further input before instituting the changes in October of this year. Response from the Advisory Committee included the change in transportation services via the connectors. The move to larger buses has limited accessibility somewhat to doorstep pickup and drop-off in certain neighborhoods and complexes. Staff is addressing this situation through purchases of buses that will better service these needs. Cindy Raskin-Schmidt, Director of Communications and Marketing, then shared the upcoming rollout for the Rider Rules of the Road. Initiated at the request of the Transit Riders Advisory Committee, this formalized set of guidelines address rider conduct on the buses themselves. User-friendly posters reflecting the rules will be placed on board buses. Four videos are being prepared that reflect riders engaging in the proper rules of conduct. The campaign encourages riders to follow the guidelines for the safety and comfort of everyone. The next Transit Riders Advisory Committee will be held on Tuesday, May 17th at 4 p.m. here at the PSTA. We encourage all of you to attend or to access the video recording of the meeting online. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Any questions, comments? Thank you for your report.
Thank you.
Our next item is a report on the Metropolitan Planning Organization, MPO report from Vice Chair Bajoski.
Thank you, Madam Chair. One of the really cool things that we heard about at the MPO meeting, we got a presentation from the Tampa Hillsborough Expressway Authority, and they are the folks that operate the Selman Extension Project. They do a number of other ones. I don't remember all of the ones that they
toll
roads. And they're just an organization amongst themselves. They use the money from the tolls to build the capital road improvements or projects, and they're sort of self-contained. So we got a presentation from them. They're going into this Solomon Extension project that they're working on. And one of the things that they mentioned, and I'm sure we'll all look into it more, I know Cassandra's working on it, is that if an organization like PSTA would want to invest in the capital side of building that road, that they would then in turn share their revenue that they receive on that toll road with us. And of course, it's all a negotiation deal, but they're doing other projects like this, I guess, and apparently it's somewhat common around the United States for this to happen. So it was just a really interesting thing that they mentioned. Whether it works for our organization, I don't know. But given our very limited revenue sources, it's certainly something to look into, because revenue coming into our capital is a one-time expenditure, but annual revenue coming into our operations is not something we have a lot of access to. So I know PSTA staff is looking into it, and I wanted to make you guys aware of that. They also discussed updating their long-range transportation plan to add water taxis and gondolas. They call it aerial propelled transit. Gondolas sound better to me. And bike sharing. Why that's just interesting is that, again, this idea of water transit is really becoming sort of the talk of the county on both sides of the bay, if you will, on our intercoastal as well as the St. Pete, Tampa side. And, you know, that's another opportunity for PSTA to diversify their business, not just in busing, but in managing a contract with water taxis, the local smaller ones in the intercoastal. So it's just something, again, for everybody to be thinking about. If you do not know this item, MPO and PPC have been working on a branding project. They're trying to figure out how do we become something besides this acronym MPO-PPC. And for, I always call my neighbor Ted, and Ted really exists. He doesn't know I talk about him all the time, but you know, how do I tell my neighbor Ted what MPO/PPC is? So they've been doing this branding with a marketing company, and the new name that they're working towards is called Forward Pinellas. Now, does that tell you what MPO and PPC does? No, but there is a little tagline underneath, and my apologies, I don't have it with me. Do you remember?
Land use and transportation planning.
Is that what it says? Pretty simple. So just trying to combine the two organizations together even more and tell people who we are. So that's been happening. And then we received a kind of Commissioner Long was there for this. We were introduced to the new Tampa Bay Regional Planning Council Executive Director, Sean Sullivan. He comes to us from New York or New Jersey.
Boston.
Well, I knew there was an accent. Yeah, I knew there was an accent, so I took a wild guess. That's right, Pop the Cop. So that was a nice introduction. It would be good to have him come here, I think, for everybody here to meet him, because you know, planning is planning, and we're part of all of that. And that's it, I think. Did I miss anything, Jordan?
I think you got it. Thank you for your report. Any questions, comments, Commissioner Long?
I don't have any questions, but and because there are four of us from the commission sitting here, I'm very limited in how I can discuss this. But Joe Gordon from FIA, the Tampa Hillsborough Expressway Authority, and myself had a meeting about a month or so ago, and actually it started when I was in Tallahassee with the legislative group, and learned that they have expanded their boundaries outside of Hillsborough, and all they had to do was be invited by another county that was contiguous to them to come have a chat with us. So I forwarded my information to Mark Woodard, and I do believe that he is projected to come and talk with our county commission about some of the potential opportunities that exist. And to that end, I think it's really important that we just stay with our minds focused on regional solutions, because I can share with you from several meetings that I've had, there's an awful lot of moving parts behind the scenes which require an awful lot of camaraderie and collaborative effort to bring the right people to the right seats and make some solid decisions. So all I can say right now is stay tuned. The future looks really, really bright for public transportation options in our region. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Great comment. Thank you. Any others? Okay, thank you. Moving right along to our consent agenda. Any board member may pull an item from the consent agenda for future discussion. If there are not, Commissioner Eckert.
Yeah, just, I wasn't here last month, so I'm not sure that I understand all of the comments that were made earlier, but I was looking at the minutes, and it certainly shows that on the issue of approving the consent that Commissioner Welch seconded that, and I just wanted to make sure that that was indeed the case, so we can kind of put that to rest, or is there an issue here that we need to deal with? Because, you know, there's a point, the time and the place to pick our battles, and I just want to make sure that we can just put this aside. So I didn't know what the detail of that issue was. So.
I'll let Mr. Zimmett comment on this, but he responded pretty thoroughly by email to Mr. Rask's comments. And certainly if there's any PSTA commissioners who are confused that what we were doing was voting on accepting the consent agenda and accepting the minutes, I didn't detect that there was any confusion. I thought we were pretty clear on that. But Mr. Zimmett, comment on that substantially, please.
Sure. The allegation is that there was a sunshine law violation because Mayor Bevis said so moved before Chair Rice had completed saying, do I have a motion to approve the consent agenda? That's the claim. So a couple things. Number one, your rules specifically state that with regard to the consent agenda, you only have two options. One is to pull an item off the consent agenda or to approve the consent agenda. The speaker said I didn't respond. I didn't respond to that latest in a series of emails because he specifically said in the prior email, and don't tell me that the rules allow the board to adopt a motion only approving the consent agenda or pulling the consent agenda item, because I don't believe that the rules would control, or some language to that effect. So I did not respond to that comment because he already indicated that he would not accept the rules as being authoritative. That's what the rules say. What happened was Chair Rice asked, just as she did today, does anybody want to pull any item off the consent agenda? She heard no response. She then said, I'll take a motion, and Mayor Bevis said, so moved. The board voted unanimously to approve. I believe they knew exactly what they were voting for, to approve the consent agenda. In light of the rules, that was the only motion that could be taken at that time. And the fact that there was no comments and the board fully and unanimously voted to approve or pass that motion, that they understood that what they were voting for. Secondly, there's no sunshine requirement that relates to this. And so it would not be a sunshine law violation. The third thing I would just point out, there were two contracts that were on the consent agenda that were, I believe, appropriately approved at that time. And staff began and implemented the approvals of those contracts. My concern is there might be some appearance that there was something wrong with what staff did, and then the fact that they moved forward with those two contracts. If you now want to reconsider the consent agenda items from last meeting, which again, I don't think you have to do. It's not a sunshine law issue, and it's consistent with your rules.
Yeah, okay, well, thank you. I certainly didn't understand the sunshine part of it at all. I certainly didn't. I thought there was some comment about a second, too, so I just think it's great. We just talked about it, get it out there so that when there's some kind of comment made, I think those of us who sit on other boards and committees, sometimes we get like, okay, move approval in a second. You kind of do it really kind of a rote thing. I think everybody's intention is that they've done their homework and are approving the consent agenda. So I don't think there was anything. But I just wanted to get that discussion. Thank you.
If there was any board member that was present that disagrees with my conclusion that you knew what you were voting on, then I think we should speak up. But I think it was pretty clear to all the board members what they were voting on.
Commissioner Welch.
Thank you, Madam Chair. To my good friend from the 4th Commission District, I can't remember what I moved or seconded last night in our meeting. So, whether I did second last month, I don't know.
Well, it says
rather than spend any money in any legal issue, why don't we just do it again and be done with it? Can we do that now?
Seriously, the whole agenda?
No, it's just a consent.
The consent from last month, you
right?
Okay, and then take this one separate.
Right? Can we do that?
You certainly can.
Commissioner Johnson.
The question that I would have is that by approving the minutes, which say basically what I think happened, I don't have details on that. Aren't we confirming effectively that the official record reflects that process as being a completed process? I guess that's a question for Mr. Zimmer. Do we need to re-vote on that?
I don't think you need to re-vote on it. I understand Commissioner Welch's comments as why even bother with the possibility that PSA could get sued and have to defend a lawsuit over this. I think everything is pretty clear, but whichever you want to do, you approve this consent agenda item. I think that clearly indicates the interest of the board members who are present, understood what they were voting on to approve the consent agenda. But I also understand where Commissioner Welch is coming from.
Now, I have a question that complicates it even more. I understand also what Commissioner Welch is saying. Can we vote on something that is not agendized? It hasn't been notified, and I mean, I know technically we can, but I'm wondering if we're opening up ourselves to another. Oh, you voted on something that you didn't advertise. I mean, I can just see that as the step to try to be more careful may put us in another harmful position. You know what I'm saying? Given the past history of what we've seen.
The law that stands today, and it is changing for special districts, because there was a statute passed that might change this, but as we sit here today, you can add something to the agenda that does not otherwise require a public notice, and approval of the consent agenda does not require any advertisement of public notice. So if you want to vote to, again, approve the consent agenda from the last meeting, you're certainly able legally to do that today.
Commissioner Long, I understand everybody's concern and everybody's desire to ensure that no stone is left unturned to satisfy a constituent who, it appears, no matter how hard we try, is not going to be satisfied with what we do. So that's number one. Number two, I don't know about everybody else, and I can't speak for everyone else, but I really do work very hard to do my homework. Our agendas are very long. And it's probably one of the most difficult boards that I sit on in terms of the issues and the many moving parts and how much of a focus you have to pay attention to in order to understand what it is you're voting on. So to ask me, I'm just talking about me personally, to vote on something that we've already done a month ago, plus today we approved the minutes reflecting what we did a month ago, to me is so abundantly clear. And I'm sorry, I just feel very uncomfortable to vote on
another whole set of issues that are not on our agenda or fresh in my mind. We have settled that. If we do this today, in my opinion, we are setting a precedent and opening ourselves up to be embroiled in a quagmire of just minutia that we've already handled. This is a big board, the issues are big, the agendas are long. That makes me more uncomfortable than knowing that I knew what I was doing. Most of us are pretty seasoned in terms of how an elected board operates, and we have lots of opportunities to ask questions, not to mention the one-on-ones that we all do with Brad if we do have questions before a meeting. So that's my thought process, and I hope we don't start down that slippery slope.
Just a long comment, I'm sure.
I'm sorry, Commissioner Milch.
I know, I still love you.
For that affirmation.
And I'm fully confident in our attorney and in the process we went through. I share with you the perspective on why these things keep coming forward. But I was in Darvin's chair on another issue a couple of years ago when we knew we were right. And we stood on principle, and it cost us down the road. I think it's, kind of penny wise, pound foolish. Just ratify the consent agenda we already approved last month, and we're done. That issue goes away. Or we stand on, we believe we're right, and I just don't want to spend another dime on a legal issue that we don't have to go through. So, that's my own thought.
If I may say, I think Commissioner Long's points are right on target, but, and I don't think that we have it, of overreacting to every single comment and criticism. But I think Commissioner Welch brings up a good point that if it's something that we can do quickly and do it now and put it to rest, let's just hear a motion in a second on reaffirming our acceptance of last month's board minutes and the consent agenda. State it clearly for the record and let's move on.
Can I just make a suggestion? If somebody's going to make that motion, that you first make a motion to add that to the agenda, the reapproval of the consent agenda from the last board meeting.
Second. Good question. Because I wasn't here last month, can I still go ahead and vote on that?
Yes.
Thank you. So it's now on the agenda?
Yes.
We have to vote on that motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, that has now been added to our agenda. May I hear a motion?
Madam Chairman, I would move to ratify the consent agenda as proposed at the March meeting, which included the following three items: board meeting minutes, lawn maintenance and related services, and remanufactured engines and transmissions.
Second.
So we have a motion and a second.
I have a question on that. Commissioner Johnson, is that the only thing that was on the consent agenda?
Those were the three elements of the consent agenda for March.
Okay.
That I looked at. And as I recall, both the lawn maintenance and the remanufactured engines went through the finance committee where there was even a recommendation for them. So those were, I believe, properly processed and recommended.
Any more questions, comments? Oh, from staff?
There's four items according to the minutes. If you look on page 10 of the minutes from the March 30th meeting, there's four items: the consent agenda, support vehicle maintenance contract, the Motorola radio maintenance contract, and the Giro Cases support upgrade.
I would like to. Oops. I'd like to withdraw my motion and substitute the proper content because I was looking at the February agenda instead of the March agenda. and that we include the minutes, the sport vehicle maintenance contract, Motorola radio maintenance contract, and then Pirate Jerome, Asus software upgrade.
And following Commissioner Johnson's leak to February, I followed that, so I would amend that motion and accept that. Amended motion is the second.
Leak to March?
Yes, yeah. I followed him.
So the second word is okay, and the changes may be the original motion?
Yes, I am. Absolutely.
Seeing no more comments, all in approval of this motion?
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. Let's move on to our other consent agenda for April. We have board meeting minutes, and we have remanufactured alternators. If there's no comments or questions or desire to pull anything from the agenda, I can accept a motion to accept the board meeting minutes from last month and the remanufactured alternators.
Sorry, just to finish
Commissioner Edwards.
Just to finish this off real quick, we need to just amend those minutes now, or to reflect the action taken today, or because we're approving the minutes from last month, just leave them alone. Just again.
Again, those minutes, I think accurate, you know,
okay.
In my opinion, accurate reflect what happened at the last meeting. The minutes for this meeting will now reflect this discussion.
Okay, and I move that we approve those minutes.
Okay, we have a clear motion and a second on this item. Do you have any questions, comments? All in favor?
Aye. The motion as approving the consent agenda for 2 minutes.
Yes.
Good.
This month.
Chair, restate the motion that this is to approve.
She said it already.
Okay.
Yeah, it was pretty clear. I picked it up. She said it already.
Thank you. I'm sorry, I lost track of where I was. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Commissioner Edwards. Let's move on to our action items. Let's get some business done here. We're going to hear a report from City Rasmussen Smith on marketing and advertising services.
Madam Chair, as City Board of Parkport, I just want to take an opportunity to thank Cindy, not only for being an Oscar-worthy director of many videos, but also for leading this procurement, which the Finance Committee unanimously approved as well. And I'm very much looking forward to having a team from a new marketing firm to help us tell our story. And finally, I want to thank Cindy for being PSTA's resident award application writer. She's the reason we won an award last week at the TVRPC's Future of the Region Awards. She's holding up the hardware there. For our Direct Connect Uber taxi pilot in Pinellas Park. So thanks, Cindy, for doing that.
Thank you. Good morning, board.
Good morning.
So you'll recall back in January, we discussed the strategic marketing plan for PSTA, which is our guideline of the work we'll be doing over the next year to communicate to the public. There were several really exciting projects that we talked about within that framework, things like market research, which is an opportunity for us to speak to the public about PSTA and the public transit services that we provide for them. A brand audit, which is a part of that, to find out how we as an agency are doing at providing that public transit. Redesigning PSTA.net to be a content focus. The regional fare collection project is coming up, and we'll be looking at what do we call that and how do we market that to the entire region. The Central Avenue BRT project is going to be coming up very quickly, and FTA in particular looks for us to have a branding plan as part of our small starts application. And then of course the Tampa International to the Beach Express service. So we have a responsibility to tell the public about all of these great services and how they can use them to improve their mobility around our county. Now, the marketing department here at PSTA, I like to say, is small but mighty. You'll see them up here in the front row. There are six of us all together, and they are all seasoned professionals. But if you remember that list from the last slide, that's a lot of work that's coming up in addition to our day-to-day work to tell the public about the services that we provide. Therefore, in January, we asked and published an RFP asking for experienced and qualified firms to join our team to supplement the work that we do here at PSTA.
We had 14 suppliers who responded. We had a really outstanding selection committee. It was made up of PSTA staff, as well as somebody from the Pinellas County Communications Department, and also from Tampa International Airport. And we kind of expanded that group a little bit because we wanted to have a regional perspective and have other people aside from just PSTA staff looking at a way that a firm would be able to help us in the future work on that regionalism. We had the top five ranked firms come and give a presentation to us. And based upon that presentation and the ranking, we are recommending today FKQ Marketing and Advertising. So this is an action item. At the end, I'll be asking for your approval to move forward with this agreement with us. One of the really great things about the firm FKQ that we discovered during their initial in-person presentation to us is their high level of creativity, their thoughtfulness and inclusiveness when they thought about how PSTA was going to be working in the community. So I'm going to show you a little video that was part of their presentation to introduce themselves to us at PSTA.
Access to area attractions, provide convenient demand response transportation, and honor our environment. With the clock ticking, one brand answers the call, and one agency has the right stuff to help them succeed. The brand is PSTA, and the agency is FKQ. With a focus on strategy, innovation, integration, and creativity, FKQ crafts stories that connect with customers and marketing plans that deliver results. From executive producers Cindy Raskin-Schmidt and Gene Smith, starring a cast of marketing and community elite, comes the story of how one brand and one agency came together to celebrate what makes their community great. From the cities to the beaches, over the bridges and down the roads, this is why we work, live, and play with PSTA.
So the first time we saw that in the room, we were all just grinning ear to ear and watching you all watch it, feeling the same joy from it that I did. It just really makes me feel good. So I'm glad you enjoyed that. So who is FKQ? They're a local firm. They're located in Clearwater, right on Roosevelt, across the street from Tech Data. We have some of them here with us. I'd like to introduce them to you. Lisa Fowler is the president and CEO. Dana Cohen is the creative director. Christine Connor-Johnson is the media director. And Kendall White is the account executive. So this is just a small group of the people that you see pictured here that will be working on PSTA's account, helping us really talk to the public, talk to customers, find out how they feel about PSTA, what we can do to provide better service, and then help us implement the educational, telling the world about what it is that PSTA does and do it in a really great and creative fashion. So I'm super excited about that. As I said, they're a full service agency, so they'll be able to help us with the research. They can help us, obviously, with video production. If we decide we want to do a commercial in the future, they can help us figure out the right way to ask the questions of the public and the right words to use to explain to them what we do. This slide shows you some of their recent clients. You'll recognize some of the logos up here. They were instrumental in the PIE rebranding that happened recently, Pinellas County's new branding, as well as they've done work for McDonald's, Transitions, Pause, the Marriott. So they have a great cast of clients, and we're really excited to be joining that cast as well. So FKQ really has a great understanding of Pinellas County and how PSTA fits into that. And they are as excited about joining the PSTA team as we are to be having them join us. So with that, I would ask that you please approve a three-year agreement with 2 one-year options with FKQ Advertising and Marketing for an amount not to exceed $2.5 million. That is $500,000 per year if we break it out. Our current marketing budget's around $300,000. So that little bit of extra gives us capacity to do some of these new projects that are coming up in the future. All the orders, all of the work that we do together will go through our normal approval process internally. And there will certainly be, you know, performance metrics that are part of every single project that we do. With that, if you have any questions, I would be happy to entertain.
Thank you for that great report, Madam Chair. Let me just, before we go to questions, I just want to see if our Finance and Performance Management Committee Chair wanted to comment. I know you guys took a look at this first, and I'll go to question.
Thank you. The committee, Finance Committee, unanimously recommended approval of this contract with FK Advertising and Marketing. The committee did discuss that this contract does not guarantee any specific expenditures, but instead will be expensed on a task order basis for each project. Commissioner Eggers, who is on our committee, requested that the staff keep the board updated on marketing tasks. And Chair Brad Miller agreed with that suggestion. The committee noted that PSTA supports its marketing efforts through its operating budget as well as specific grant-funded initiatives like the Central Avenue BRT.
Thank you. Commissioner Long.
Well, I am just really, I don't even have the words to explain how thrilled I am with this ad, and I would be very interested. And I'm thrilled to see that the folks that are behind the scenes, there's a lot of women. Sorry, guys, but seriously, there are some immediate thoughts that come to my mind of knowing about some of the moving parts that are going on. I'd be very interested in a conversation about the marketing strategy and how flexible they might be to, as we move forward with some of the moving parts and pulling them all together, how flexible they might be to move along with us in that direction.
So, I think
but I'm just stunned. I mean, it is incredible, and I surely hope that there will be some effort to bring this video to the County Commission and to the Tampa Bay Regional Community Council, the MPO, and the PBC, all of them that are involved in trying to find transportation solutions for our region. Fabulous.
Thank you. Any other comments, questions? Commissioner Walsh.
Thank you. I'm certainly not going to make a comment about one that does the work. And FDQ has done a great job with the county, and that kind of creativity is just the norm, so I'm supportive. My only question is on the budget. To fully expend that, we'd have to increase the budget from 300 to 500.
No, this contract just gives us the capacity in the future to have the room available to do that work. There are other places that money in the future could come from. For example,
okay. The
regional fare collection system, there's an opportunity there for the other agencies that are participating in that project to help us fund it.
Okay, so this allows us to come from that particular line.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, thank you.
Exactly.
Commissioner Johnson.
Thank you. At the Finance Committee, I believe I discussed a little bit about the terminology of marketing PSTA, and this was something that I think I brought up when we were actually talking about the strategy here, and but I'd just like to go on record as saying what I look at in marketing is not expanding our sales in a traditional for-profit organization sense. We are here to serve our public with whatever level of service they ask for, and that's the communications outreach part of this plan, and then explaining those services that we are implementing. Clearly, if we roll out the new fare box, we're going to have to provide some communication to the public as to how that would work, how it's going to impact them. As we roll out new routes or adjust routes, again, we're rolling out and communicating to the public. We're not building our empire, and with that comment, I'm going to support this. Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Barkley.
I understand Commissioner Johnson's concern. However, we have a social obligation to not only provide service to the public and to let the public know what those services are so that we can be an environmentally beneficial enterprise for our county and our region. It is extremely important that we, not for purposes of producing income, but for purposes of helping our citizenry, that we provide adequate knowledge and education with regard to having more riders, because every rider that we take out of a car and put on a bus or ultimately a rail vehicle will benefit the environment and benefit the growth of new job opportunities in our region.
Commissioner Eckers and then Vice Chair.
And I wanted to echo those comments, Commissioner Barkley. I just really believe that ultimately our responsibility is to provide that service to our residents. But at the same time, it's to be a financially viable institution that can withstand the test of time and be a sustainable force. And so for us to be able to continue to develop some of the services that we have, which we have done and we've got an award for, which congratulations again, I think it's incumbent upon us to tell the story and to let people know where we are expanding, at the same time listening to those folks that are now starting to perhaps, hopefully, start to become riders. So I think it is incumbent upon us to try to expand the base, because certainly the base of riders is very small. And for us to continue to be that financially viable group, we have to continue to try to do that. So we do have that responsibility, not as a for-profit, but certainly in the mindset of a for-profit, expanding ridership is critical for the success of this organization long term. So I support this.
Thank you.
I'm always supportive of this kind of thing. You know, kind of my neighbor Ted that I talked about a while ago, you know, they have two cars in their driveway. I don't think they ever even think about getting on the bus, and obviously when you see our ridership, you know, with the population that we have here in Pinellas County, that's probably similar to many people. And so branding ourselves, being on television, being in print work, making people, you know, they know who PSTA is, but giving them a sense of internal comfort, which is really what this is about
changing the
culture. Yes, changing the culture and internal comfort. Oh, the bus. Oh yeah, I'm taking my car in. Yeah, I could use the bus. Or did you know PSTA does the trolley? Oh, I could grab the trolley. Maybe someday PSTA is doing a water taxi. You know, people don't know those things unless they're avid users. So being able to do all of this does change the culture, does market yourself and brand yourself, which I think is important just to get the potential of new ridership and for all the other reasons everybody else has said. I was with a company by the name of Patchington for 20 years, and we did a very small contract with FKQ. And so I very much remember them, and they were very creative, and so I'm very supportive of the contract.
Well, thank you. So what I need is to hear a motion to approve the three-year contract with two additional one-year renewals with FKQ Marketing and Advertising for a cost not to exceed. Let me finish my sentence. For a cost not to exceed $2.5 million over the maximum five-year period.
Move approval, please.
Second.
Great. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
Yes, we do need public comment. Sorry. Oh. Any public comments on this item? We have not received any green cards indicating public comment, and we're giving the option for anyone who wants to comment on it now. and seeing nary a peep, we will move on. Thank you.
Great job, thank you.
Congratulations. Looking forward to working with you.
Okay, so our next item, informational item, is on succession planning and employee development from Trish Collins. This is something our board has been talking about for quite a while, and we're eagerly looking forward to the report.
Yes, Madam Chair, as you know, my performance evaluation included, that was completed last month, included a sort of to be continued item. And I'm sorry that maybe we don't have a beautiful video part of this presentation, but nonetheless, I am thrilled to introduce Trish Collins from our HR department, who's been working very hard on what I believe is a very comprehensive succession plan for PSBA. The reason I like it so much, maybe not as exciting as the video, but it is what I love about my job the most, because it emphasizes investing and developing all of our PSBA employees. So, Trish.
Thank you, good morning. Board members, happy to be here today. Today I'm gonna discuss an informational item with you. As has been introduced, our succession planning and employee development programs. The board's aware that PSBA has undertaken a comprehensive succession planning effort over the last 6 months. And we did this with two main goals in mind. One is to prepare for future departures and be able to ensure a smooth continuation of operations in that event. And the second, as Brad said, is to develop strong leaders and contributors throughout our entire organization. Succession planning is one important piece of a robust workforce management strategy that includes other components like leadership development, training, staffing, and performance management. Effective, sustainable succession planning is about all of these components and far more than just naming one successor to a particular position. If you'll allow me, I'm a Midwestern girl originally, so I'd like to use a farming analogy for how these components work together. If you think of succession planning as deciding what crops you're going to plant, then staffing is acquiring the high quality seeds that you need. Training and development on the water, the sunshine, the nurturing that your plants need in order to grow. Performance management would be the trellis that makes sure your crops are growing in the right direction. So a good farmer is tending to their entire crop with all of these components in order to ensure a successful season, if you will. So PSBA wants to be that good farmer. Our approach is to invest in the development of all of our employees. We have, and we can continue to build, successful programs that deliver targeted training and development opportunities. And this is an important piece of our overall succession plan. We began our succession planning effort with identifying the key positions throughout our entire organization. And we followed a logical and a thorough approach for everyone, developing a long and short-term succession plan for each key position. Our next step was to conduct an analysis of our current conditions, and we asked each chief and director five key questions. The first question is, for each key position, what is the anticipated vacancy risk? And we evaluated each one as low, medium, or high. A high vacancy risk would be the position may be vacant right now, or we have reasonable expectation that it may be within the next 12 months. Medium risk is that there's potentially an anticipated vacancy within 1 to 3 years. And a low risk would be a position that we don't anticipate to be vacant for 3 or more years. In looking at vacancy risk, of course, one of the things that we consider are pre-planned retirements. For example, our Superintendent of Transportation, Shelby Harris, is going to be retiring at the end of May after 35 dedicated years of service here at the SDA. Obviously, as part of our analysis, we rated her position as a high vacancy risk. And we're taking proactive steps right now to capture, document, and share that institutional knowledge that she has, to make sure that when she does leave and she's off enjoying her new free time, we have a smooth continuation and transition to her successor. Since the board's specific responsibility is to oversee the CEO position, I'd like to discuss that position individually. As part of our analysis, we rated the current CEO vacancy risk as medium. Is that right, Brad?
As of a few weeks ago, I told Trish to move the tarp and back to medium.
The second question that we ask for every key position is, what is the plan if this position is vacant tomorrow? For example, what if someone unexpectedly goes on long-term disability? We call this our emergency interim plan. What do we do on day one when that position is open? And we determine the plan of action for every single key position in the organization. In some cases, that plan is to temporarily fill the position with an interim. In other cases, the plan is to temporarily distribute the key roles of the position among several people. As a reminder, we did this for every position. For the CEO's position, in the event of a vacancy, of course, it's the board's decision how to proceed. Staff would recommend that we name an interim, our Chief Development Officer, Cassandra Borchers, as our interim CEO in the event of vacancy. The third question that we ask for every key position is, what is the long-term succession plan? For most positions that we analyzed, the plan was to proceed with a competitive hiring process while the immediate duties are taken care of with the emergency interim plan. Again, you know, for the board, it will be your decision how to proceed in the event of the CEO's vacancy. Our recommendation would be to conduct a national search. That's what's been done with every PSTA CEO or CEO vacancy since 1974. That's not to say that we don't believe that our recommended interim would do a great job. This is just a recommendation in line with board's history. The next piece of our analysis was to ask our department heads to identify the high potential employees within their department. So looking at their team strengths and looking for the employees who are demonstrating both the interest and the capacity to move into positions of higher level leadership throughout the organization. It's best practice to identify a pool of high potential employees and invest in their development. So that allows for a broad and diverse base of potential candidates to step forward to be considered at the time that there may be a leadership vacancy. It also allows for flexibility in making sure that you're selecting the candidate who best represents and can fulfill the needs of the position at the time that the position becomes vacant. In the case of our CEO role, all four of our chiefs are identified as high potential employees. Cassandra Borchers, our Chief Development Officer, James Bradford, our Chief Operating Officer, Debbie Leas, our Chief Financial Officer, and Sangeeta Land, our Chief Compliance Officer. Any or all of them could potentially step forward to be considered for the CEO role. We have identified high potential employees throughout the entire organization. Again, these are employees who've demonstrated more than just excellence in their current position. High potential employees also show that they want to and are capable of taking on higher level responsibilities. They've got a history of success with things like stretch assignments, proactive self-development, and a sustained drive for continuous improvement. We're continually evaluating for high potential, and we're building that into our performance management process. We want to give all of our high potential employees the tools that they need and the opportunities to become ready to take that next step up, and the ability to grow in their current positions. The development programs I'll describe shortly are aimed at those goals and are also powerful retention tools to help strong employees decide that PSTA is the right place for them to spend their career. The last question of our analysis is, what kind of development programs are best suited to support our entire employee base and our high potential employees? A lot of careful thought and work went into that process. We looked at best practices from public and private employers. We looked at applicable models from peers like Pinellas County. We looked at the Society for Human Resources Management documentation and research on this. And of course, we also had to importantly consider what works best for us at PSTA to make sure that our specific goals are successful in moving forward. The result of this are programs to address employee development on two fronts. One is our existing training, the various existing training programs that we currently have going on. We call that PSTA University. And the second is our new leadership development program called Leadership PSTA. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. PSTA University, again, encompasses all of the training that we're already doing here at PSTA. It's really the backbone that helps us provide efficient, effective service for our customers and have effective work processes here within the agency. This includes the training that's delivered through our transportation department, primarily through our safety, security, and training team, and our manager of coaching and performance development. So they're providing new operator training, defensive driving training, behavior coaching, customer service training, transit supervision training, and accident investigation training. We also have a fantastic maintenance program, training coordinated by our superintendent of training and technical services. So he's facilitating training on technical equipment specific items, like how to work on our hybrid systems for our mechanics, how to repair and maintain our transmissions, brake systems, and other technical training, as well as important safety training to make sure that we're preventing accidents and injury on the job. We also provide training through PSTA University for our administrative support employees. So that's job-specific and career development training, like supervisory and team management skills, professional certifications, time management, communications, computer skills, business writing, and compliance training like public records compliance and anti-harassment and other compliance trainings. So these programs together are already achieving great results. Our PSTA maintenance training has been recognized for excellence among our best bus benchmarking team. Our customer service training initiative over the last 12 months contributed to PSTA's customer satisfaction rating that was recently recognized as being 2.5 times the national average. And our safety, security, and training team has developed many of their curriculum elements in-house that have been widely recognized for quality and are being used as models for statewide standards for bus operator training. So in addition to the training that we're already doing through PSTA University, we're also very excited to introduce in 2016 Leadership PSTA. When this is launched, Leadership PSTA will be our premier professional development program. It's designed to support and develop our high potential employees who have the capacity and aspiration to grow into advanced leadership positions with the agency. Employees selected for the program will participate in curriculum design specifically not only develop their transit and technical industry knowledge, but also the characteristics that are needed to lead teams within their department and within the larger organization. So curriculum activities through Leadership PSTA will include enhanced participation in PSTA projects, meetings, and committees, opportunities to research and recommend innovative solutions for real-life PSTA issues, community outreach experiences, participation in transit industry events, and also training designed to target these specific selected skills. Graduates of Leadership PSTA won't be guaranteed leadership positions in the future, but the valuable learning experiences that they have in the program will make them stronger contributors in their current roles and more competitive, strong candidates to step forward and be considered for future leadership roles. So rather than predetermined replacements, this creates a pool of highly skilled and motivated employees who are ready to be considered for future leadership roles. In summary, we have created a comprehensive plan that considers both the short and the long-term development and succession planning needs of PSTA. We're moving forward with strategic investment in all of our employees, both to support their success in their current roles and to prepare high potential employees for future leadership growth. Our succession plan and our employee development programs, working in harmony with the other elements of our workforce management strategy, will ensure that PSTA's operations, our service, and our path forward continue seamlessly as we see changes in the future. Thank you, and I'm happy to take any questions you have.
Thank you, Trish.
great report, very informative, very comprehensive. Do we have any questions and comments, Commissioner Barkley and Commissioner Roach?
Yes, thank you. Very good report. Really appreciate it. Is there a specific methodology for identifying people who might fit into the special program that you're describing, or is it sort of a self-identification where people essentially volunteer?
Sure, thank you. That's a great question. So for Leadership PSTA, we are working out on a nomination process. So each department will have an opportunity to nominate the candidate they feel from their department best represents success for the position or for that program.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Trish, great job. This is very good. And Brad, I want to commend you on this. This has been very responsive to a longstanding board concern. It's great for the organization to have this, but it's also great for the board to have this plan. My question is, where does this live going forward? It's not a board policy, so is this part of the strategic plan? Where is this actually documented?
Sure. Well, Human Resources will take the lead on the facilitation for this plan, as we have, but it takes input from all of the chiefs and the directors around the organization. It's a living plan, so we'll continue to monitor it on the
office. So is it part of PSTA's strategic plan? If I want to go look this up, where would it be?
Sure. Well, it would be within HR's documents, so we'd be happy to provide those for you.
Okay.
Mr. Welch, we have included a written narrative of sort of the process we went through in your packet. Mm-hmm. Obviously, sort of a document. Some of these issues, especially in departments that have multiple folks, maybe at the same level, can perhaps in some cases be somewhat sensitive. So it is public record. We will put the general framework up on our website, no doubt. But not necessarily. It'll stay within an HR document.
And not trying to get into specific, personnel names, but like our path forward, everybody has this, and then we find it.
Yeah.
It's a common document. I'd like to do the same for the succession plan framework.
Oh,
so
yeah.
That
certainly.
As the board changes, other things change, we know that is the plan.
Yeah.
But a great job going forward. Thank you, Madam Chair.
You're very welcome. And it does relate to the third bullet under focus on customer-oriented public transit services is build an inspired workforce that is empowered and accountable for ever-improving customer service. So I think that's definitely where it relates. I guess the question is how can we now define it where it relates to that strategic plan? Commissioner Long?
Yes, and I totally agree with Commissioner Welch. This is such an important component of our path forward, strategic plan, whatever you're talking about. And it's great for everyone that's currently here on the board, as well as our staff that are involved in all of this. But I do believe that this should be a board decision that we make. I don't know exactly what the technicalities of it might be, but it definitely needs to be a component within our approved strategic plan that we did. And we're getting ready to have another workshop to look at this and see if any of it needs to be updated, changed, or whatever. So perhaps that's a time to have a little more in-depth about where we think it should. I agree it should be in Human Resources, and that's not an issue, but the fact of the matter is it should be clear that this board thoroughly endorses and supports this. And I do think it should be a policy issue. It is a policy. I mean, we haven't even had one of these kind of things in place before, and that's one thing we've been really dinging Brad for in his evaluations, that we didn't have it. So I agree with Commissioner Welch. It needs to be formally adopted or something.
And I hear your comments. No, they're sound of love. So what I would propose is First, I think it's a great idea to include the framework discussion for in the new board member orientation. Whenever we get a new board member, I meet with them one-on-one. We go over all of the policies and procedures and how the board operates. And this, I think, would be a key component to that initial discussion. And then if you're okay, we can come back next month with the framework as an approved PSBA board policy. Add to our policy book.
Thank you.
Commissioner Rogers? I would third those comments about making it a policy statement. It is kind of embedded a little bit in there, building an inspired workforce. Also, I mean, I think anything we can do to pass along that support to HR, which I'm sure has been doing a lot of this in some way anyway, but this is a great way to pull it together. And my only comment would be, and again, at the risk of stepping out, you might be saying something that was repeating, so I apologize ahead of time for that. But I think that having a good balance between developing our workforce and having a great recruiting approach too is important. I mean, I think any organization over the long term, new, fresh blood coming in, at the same time, an opportunity for our staff to elevate themselves to different levels. So just to continue having that balance is really important. And finally, I would just say that I think your Midwestern family would be proud of your analogy today. Remembering your roots are important, pun intended, but thank you for doing a good job.
Well, thank you again, Trish, and I hope you heard that. I mean, this was just a great report, and this work is just so integral to building the leadership management of our staff that the feedback that you're getting to want to make this a policy means that it's so important that we want to wear it on our sleeve.
I appreciate that. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Obviously, Trish was named as a high potential.
Thank you. Our next item, again, something I know I've been looking forward to hearing for a while, is our sustainability plan from Heather Sobosch.
Yeah, and just to introduce this discussion, mindful of our time, I'm sure we can have a long discussion about this, but the idea of Heather's presentation today is to introduce perhaps a new framework for evaluating and making decisions about PSBA's sustainable fleet plan, as well as an update on our overall sustainability efforts. We had a great Earth Day celebration, as you heard last week, where we highlighted that the most important function that PSBA provides to our community is a transportation alternative to driving cars. That we carry riders, they don't drive cars. That is our biggest benefit to the community from a sustainability perspective. And Heather will kind of outline those benefits as well as other sustainability programs that we have going on at PSBA.
Thank you. As Brad said, this is an informational item on our sustainability planning efforts, and it has been reviewed at the Planning and Finance Committees last week. We are bringing this to you all now for a couple of reasons. One, for the first time, we've submitted some of our sustainability achievements to the American Public Transportation Association for recognition as part of their sustainability program. And then also, as Brad said, we believe that this is the appropriate context to discuss our bus fleet replacement plan as we talk further about our five-year budget. So what is sustainability? It is essentially looking at how we can incorporate environmental, social, and financial sustainability and responsibility in our organizational decision-making. It is ensuring that we meet our needs today, but that we also maintain the flexibility to continue to meet our needs in the future. PSBA, as the provider of public transportation in Pinellas County, which is our mission, is a major contributor to our community's sustainability. Again, as Brett said, one of the top actions a person can take to be environmentally sustainable is to ride the bus. It reduces emissions, it reduces fossil fuel use in our greater community. PSBA also connects people to jobs, to shopping, to healthcare, and in all of these ways, we help to improve the overall economic vitality of Pinellas County. sustainability is not new to PSCA. We were one of the founding signatories to APTA's sustainability commitment. We, years ago, set a policy on environmental sustainability, and then more recently have incorporated sustainability throughout our Path Forward strategic plan in all of those elements of sustainability, environmental, financial, and social. At PSCA, we've taken a very traditional sustainability planning approach. This involves establishing a baseline for different activities and measuring those, for setting goals to make improvements above that baseline, and then implementing initiatives that help us achieve those goals, and then finally measuring them. Some of our more recent significant accomplishments include improving a much improved tracking system and then increasing our recycling and reuse program. From a social sustainability perspective, we have greatly increased access to transportation for people who are transportation disadvantaged, and also for students through our UPass program, through our First Mile, Last Mile Direct Connect program, and through an expanded transportation disadvantaged program. From an environmental perspective, we have been increasing the number of hybrid vehicles in our fleet. We have increased them from 32 to 60. We also, as you're aware, have 7 new BAE series electric buses that we'll be receiving soon. And from what other areas of experience, those have a greater fuel economy than our current fleet. So we're looking forward to that. Speaking of these bus replacements, if we think about the bus replacements in terms of the sustainability planning approach, we can establish a baseline for fuel economy. And this is actually an idea that was brought to us by Chair Rice a little while ago. And then look at ways for improving above that baseline over time. This would be for our entire fleet, our average fuel economy. It's important to look at our entire fleet. We operate buses of all shapes and sizes. We have small gasoline powered buses, hybrid buses, diesel buses, soon these new BAE series electric buses. And then hopefully we can get some of that grant funding to include some battery powered electric buses in our fleet. And by looking at this, establishing a baseline and improving the baseline, we could do this instead of setting a specific policy and locking us into a specific policy on a bus type. So if our goal is to reduce our use of fossil fuels, we just kind of came up with a couple examples. If you look at the extreme, we could reduce all of the vehicles in PSCA's fleet. Of course, then we would fail to provide our mission of providing public transportation services. And probably increase the emissions and the fossil fuel use in our greater community as people were to drive more. We could also we're going to buy all electric vehicles. However, the cost of not only the vehicle, but also the infrastructure required would require us to cut services in order to balance the budget. Again, this would not allow us to conduct our mission of providing public transportation services to as many people as possible. And would not let us meet our social and financial sustainability goals. So right now, our average fleet fuel economy for fiscal year 2015 was 4 miles per gallon. So what we would do is set a percentage increase that we would seek to achieve and say through our fleet and our bus replacement plan, achieve an increase in that over the next couple of years. In summary, we know that it is very important to have a long-term sustainable financial plan. And as part of this, we believe that the fleet purchases should be done using the sustainability model, and that this would allow us to balance the environmental, social, and financial sustainability and responsibility over that five-year program. In May, you will be seeing this in the context of the proposed capital improvement program. So with that, I'll turn it over to the chair for any questions or comments.
Thank you for your report, Heather. I think this is a really great discussion to have. I'm certainly, and I'm sure some of the board members are too, very sympathetic and really want to look at any way possible we can afford to buy things like electric buses. Mm-hmm. But the reason I think this conversation is really helpful is, you know, zeroing in on the technology of a specific bus is very tactical, and what we need is a strategy and a lens for making these decisions, keeping in mind that sustainability means economic and social considerations as well. So I heard Commissioner Wong has a question, and then Commissioner Scott.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Well, not so much a question, as a, maybe I have a question and a comment. I find 4 miles per gallon just incredibly, I mean, outrageous. 4 miles per gallon? Is that the average nationwide for a bus, Brad?
Yes.
Seriously?
It's substantially larger and bigger than a car.
Well then, what is the miles per gallon, for example, an electric bus?
21.
Is it seriously?
Yeah.
Well then,
and the hybrid too. What is it for the hybrid?
The hybrid gets, depending on where it runs, but between 5 and 6 miles a gallon. The new electric series BAE buses we're going to get in the fall are getting 8 miles a gallon in Boston. It's somewhat similar to the way they're going to get 8.
So now, Chair, I don't follow. Then, considering the comment that Commissioner Welch just made, why are we having a baseline of 4 miles per gallon? Because, I mean, I just find that
that was our
that's
current,
where we are now.
That was our fiscal year 2015 average, fleet average. And we are operating in an urban environment. So, you know, with your car, if you're on the highway, you can get a lot better miles per gallon than with your truck stop and go in our streets.
So I'd like to see if we can move this issue to our workshop and have in-depth discussion. I mean, I just think that's not acceptable.
But ironically, the hybrids get better mileage and stop and go because they use the regenerative braking. So the long headway routes would have more mileage with a diesel bus, but less so with the hybrids. Hybrids do better stop and go.
Correct.
Commissioner Scott, then Commissioner Eggers, and then Commissioner Welch.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. Thanks, Heather. Great. I think that's a great presentation. I really like the idea of pinning this to miles per gallon because it's something that everybody can understand. I mean, MPG is something that we as a board understand, it's something the general public understands, so I think that's a great way to go about this. What I would like to see is, I think I might have brought this up at the finance committee meeting, is when we go to make our next bus purchasing decision, is that layout of the fleet where we have 10 2001s or whatever it is, 12 2002s, all the way up the line, and what the average MPG of that segment of the fleet is that we're looking to replace. So when that falls off, what the MPG would be if we bought diesel, what it would be if we bought hybrid, and so forth. I think that would help us make a very informed decision. So I think this is great, and appreciate the effort.
Thank you. And we actually have already started that analysis and then also looking at the emissions of the different fleets we operate.
Thank you, Commissioner Eggers.
Yeah, also I wanted to say thank you. I think this is the right way to look at it from the balanced perspective of social, environmental, and financial perspectives that we need to kind of keep in mind. And I think the Commissioner Long's comment about, boy, that seems awfully low. I think that there's a greater discussion to be had, and I appreciate your comment on that. And, but the simple fact is that if that is an average number, I mean, that's reality. Again, we're talking about reality of today, and where we're heading down the road, that's kind of what we're talking about. So from my perspective, and I really don't. I mean, I don't have a preconceived notion. I mean, I always speak to the benefits of the diesel from the perspective of our responsibility to our riders and that kind of thing. But, you know, if we can get, and this is what we've been working on, I know that there seems to be a discrepancy between folks that we hear from and staff about purchase cost comparisons, okay? I mean, I hear that, you know, in one framework, I hear there's 400,000, 450,000 for a diesel, 800, whatever it is for a hybrid, and then, you know, electric buses are more. And then I hear from the outside folks saying, no, they're cheaper today. So that there's facts that we need to get from the perspective of purchase cost comparison. I think the same thing from a maintenance cost comparison. If we're making these decisions on a financial versus social versus environmental, that we're not getting the right information, and I'm not suggesting we're not getting the right information, I'm just saying we've got to get the right information to make the right decision, because ultimately, when you have, and I don't want to quote the wrong number, but when you have 1.5% of our population using buses, you know, to your point about 4 miles a gallon, that's really not very good. And so how do we get there? How do we not only make sure we have financial sustainability for our riders that have to have buses? I mean, you know, they probably like to see twice as many buses, and to heck with environmental, let's just make sure we're getting the right, the more service. And I'm not saying all riders. I'm just saying that there's a component of having dependability and more service and all the other issues that we're talking about. So I really think this is the right way to look at it. I'm not sure what numbers or things we should look at. I think NPG is a good one. But from my perspective, as we go through this tactical decision about bus purchase this year, I just want to make sure we're getting all of the right information so that we can make good decisions for this organization, for our riders, and our greater community. So, thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Ivers. Commissioner Welch?
Thank you, Madam Chair. I agree with everything that Commissioner Ivers said.
I was going to say,
in addition to that, I want to thank you, Madam Chair, for bringing this approach forward, because it is really about balance between those three, environmental, financial, and social responsibilities. And I think words matter, and I'm uncomfortable that we're now calling the hybrids electrics. That's what we've been calling hybrids, so I want to keep that straight in my mind. The VAEs are hybrids. But the other point is having the most current data, because the price point for the electrics is changing. It's changed over the last year that we've talked about. And we really need to have the right data on that, as Commissioner Edwards said, because when we talk about total cost of ownership, what I'm hearing and some of our research shows that the payback on those electrics has really come down. So whenever we make that decision, you know, it's going to be about balancing those three. At the end of the day, the folks who are dependent on transportation can't have it and have a really environmentally responsible fleet that doesn't meet the need isn't what we want. But on the other hand, and I told Brad this from day one, I don't think MPG can be our sole measure. As Miami streets are filling with ocean water, you know, we can't change the whole sea level rise issue, but we can be a leader. And if other transit agencies have that same approach, well, we can't affect it, then it never gets changed. So I just have an open mind as well moving forward, but I think we need to have current information moving forward. I look forward to that workshop after.
Commissioner Gerard, and then Vice Chair Bajowski.
And I think I agree with everything that's been said so far. By everyone. I agree with Commissioner Long that I'd like to have a more in-depth discussion about this before we have some decision point in May or August or whenever the heck we're deciding what kind of buses to buy. So we're not in the same, and I've said this before, in the same position this year that we were in last year, and trying to make that without all the information that we need. And again, lifespan expenses is what I'd like to see, what Commissioner Scott was saying about the initial cost, the lifespan, the MPGs and all that, and I don't think that can be the only measure either. I just want to see a balance between environmental issues and budget and social issues, because I still think we're looking a lot at the financial and not as much as those other two ends. And I don't want to lock us into any one decision, but I want to have all the information when I make that decision this time. So, and I don't feel like I have it yet. Just give me a bunch of numbers on a page and I'll figure it out.
Be careful what you ask for.
Yeah, I know. But
we can make numbers.
Lots of numbers.
Okay, Vice Chair Bajowski, then Commissioner Johnson, and then Commissioner Scott.
Okay, thank you, Madam Chair. I liked what
And I too agree with many of what's been said. I liked what Mr. Scott had to say because, you know, looking at the groups you're replacing and having being able to understand what the improvement is from that group to what you're buying, and then how does that affect the total? I think those are important things with the MPGs. I do like that it's a balanced plan, but I also very much agree with what Commissioner Walsh was saying, is that at some point with the sea level rise issue, you just have to bite the bullet. And the reason certain technologies are more expensive, I mean, if you remember when the VCR came out years ago, nobody ever thought they could afford a darn thing, but that's because nobody had one. And as the market started flooding with it, the price came down. Well, if people don't start biting the bullet, the price on these things are never gonna come down. I'm not saying that our residents have to take the brunt of that financial hit, but we do have to, you know, kind of think about that. And I would also say that I would hope along the way that we as a board or Brad or the planning committee, the finance committee, would welcome the Sierra Club in to talk about this policy. Because what I don't want to see, I want us to be working together to get to the end result. Now, we may not agree on every fine point, but in general, in concept, if we agree, then we're not going to have the same situation this coming summer as we did last year. And I think it's important, you know, this organization is an environmental watchdog. It does help us stay on our toes, it helps everybody stay on our toes. So I think we're better served if we're working together as a partner, and that we're in more or less agreement on how we're moving forward. I think that's the best way to go. So if those conversations have not occurred, I would ask that they do.
Commissioner Jensen?
Thank you. Just to reinforce a couple of things, I think that Commissioner Eggers said, it's about balance, social, economic, and environment. We have to have common facts. It doesn't do us any good if we get to a meeting and we have people saying, well, here's the facts. The other thing, just in quickly closing, the 4 miles per gallon is 40 miles per gallon if we have 10 passengers on the bus, or if we have 20 passengers on the bus, it's 80 miles per gallon.
Commissioner Scott.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Actually, that was kind of the point I was just going to make, is that 4 miles per gallon is like sort of a shock to the senses. When you look at passenger miles per gallon, it is a completely different situation. So I think maybe we want to look at that as a metric too, is what is our current passenger miles per gallon? And what would it be with the various options we're going to consider? And then also kind of looking out too, when the real win is the amount of service we put on the streets and the amount of cars we take off the road. So keeping incremental expansion in mind, if we bought X number of buses at this price versus X number of buses at that price, what could potentially our passenger miles per gallon be? So I think that would be a good way of looking at it.
Yes, thank you.
Thanks.
Commissioner Hartman.
Yes, I would just like to add to the conversation here that when we make a bus purchase, we're talking about something that's going to be on the street for 12 or 15 years. And so when we buy old technology, we are buying into another 10 to 15 year delay in updating our fleet. So buying more of the same does not help our image, does not help the environment, does not help us in moving forward as a dynamic, growing, cutting-edge field for our PSTA passengers or for our community. So we have to consider, in addition to all the other comments, which are all excellent, we have to consider the fact that This is not, you know, buying a car that we're going to keep for 3 years, or a washing machine we're going to keep for 5 years. We're going to keep this for a very long time, and we have to make sure that we take into account where the industry is heading and where technology is heading, so that we're not, in effect, going backwards. And I think we have to factor that into our calculus. So with regard to Commissioner Gerard's comments of all the numbers, there also has to be our own ability to look forward into the future as much as possible, and to identify where the industry as a whole is heading, where technology is heading, and where our organization needs to be heading. We need to be out in front. We need to be a leader. And that's a very important part of this calculus that we're talking about.
Well said.
Great.
I have a, this is, these are really great comments. This is an important discussion. I think we all want to see PSTA be a leader in sustainability and make comprehensive and smart decisions about how we get there. I did have a quick question for you, Heather. On the summary page, it's referred to staff submitted PSTA's baseline information for recognition at the bronze level. And if I understand correctly, with APTA, what we apply to see how we get to the bronze level, and then that starts us into a process where we would shoot for a higher level. I just like to hear us shoot a lot higher than that as our goal, and so I don't want to get tripped up too much on semantics here, but I'd like to see us do better than bronze.
Yes, they actually, we had a signatory where we were signatory, and then we were working towards bronze, and there are a number of sustainability measures, not just related to fuel use. And so we did submit to receive the bronze level, which is kind of the first level of recognition based on some other things. So on our increase in our recycling rate, on our expansion of the TD program, the E-Pass programs, and a number of other things. So we did have some baselines for those from 2013 that we were able to submit on. But yes, our longer term goal would be to work our way up to silver, gold, and then they actually have a platinum level.
Great. And I noticed that APTA is having a sustainability conference in Austin, I think in July. And I think that would be great if you or you be designated as our sustainability champion on the staff side were to attend that. I think that would be a great idea. Okay, so let's thank you for that great discussion. Let's move on. Thank you, Heather.
Thank you.
Let's move on to our reports and correspondence. Brad?
Thank you. I think as was mentioned earlier in the meeting, we've had a technical glitch with our financial system and tracking system that has been recently rectified. So in your packet is the February ridership data now, and soon we'll be setting up the March and then getting up caught up through the month of April. I am excited to have this week be officially PSTA's Largo week. We are opening up our new transit center at Largo Common, the Walmart at US 19 in Roosevelt. It actually will be open for customers, and the buses will be moving in there on May 1st, next week. But we are having our ribbon cutting tomorrow. You're all invited. Hopefully Commissioner Finger will feel better and be able to attend that tomorrow at 1 o'clock at the Largo Transit Center. I think there'll be several, the mayor and city manager and other folks from Largo there. We also will be having you'll see a video, hopefully, about that this Friday. And then we're going to have our next Rider Town Hall, that where we go and we listen to customers and their thoughts. That's going to be next Friday afternoon, after the PSTA Board Workshop, which is a week from this Friday on May 6th. It's a 3-hour workshop. Right now we have it planned to have two main focuses. We discussed this at the planning committee earlier this week. It's sort of a two-part workshop. Part one is a higher level discussion on ever-evolving transportation technology and public transit's role within that technology. Dr. Steve Polzin from USF is scheduled to come speak. He's got a presentation that I think some of you maybe have seen on showing how public transit fits into these futuristic things like Uber and Lyft and autonomous vehicles, etc. And then part two of the meeting is sort of segueing into a discussion that's come out of our legislative discussions about maybe presenting a new framework for the value of thinking in a regional context about the benefits that regional transportation solutions provide. And I've got Whit Blanton, who's going to give a presentation on some case studies from other communities around the country that have had regional success or that have thought regionally about transportation and had some success. So look forward to seeing you all next Friday at that. I think that concludes my report. Wait, one more quick thing. In your packet is some of the reports that the committee's received. The planning committee got a presentation, a presentation, and the track committee did as well, on the upcoming changes to our routes and services that are planned for this coming October. We are just kicking off the discussion with the planning committee. This is the staff work based on the community bus plan and our work to modernize and make more efficient all of the routes and our services. And in your packet on page 84 is a list of all of the public meetings. We're now that we've gone to the planning committee, received feedback internally, we're gonna get feedback through the month of May. There's a whole bunch of meetings. We'll try to invite you to one specifically in your area. Almost all the changes we're proposing for October are in northern Pinellas County, north of Olmerton Road. And so that's where the meetings mostly are. The idea is to model the public involvement off of our very successful public involvement that we had down in St. Petersburg for the change to a grid system and away from Williams Park, where we had a very robust set of input meetings, and then we had approval of the plan, and then we had a whole bunch of informational team of yellow vested people out there telling customers about the changes coming up. And so we've got that same kind of scenario planned for this. May and June input, and then board action in June, and then July, August, September, yellow vested people at Countryside Mall and other places informing the community, informing the public about what the changes will be. It's not a matter of cutting routes. It's a matter of providing, we think, better, more streamlined services. That's all on our website. It's on the draft proposals, and then we'll be launching, sending that out to the community in the next couple of weeks. That concludes my report.
Thank you. Vice Chair Pajowski?
Yeah, just have a quick question for Brad. Brad, and it was mentioned earlier under citizen input, but I presume we're doing something, and maybe you can share with us what we're doing to research and address the reduction in ridership that we're seeing. Do you have a feel for what might be causing this? I think the report we received separately via email was for really only 2 months. Or was it was it January, February, or was it from October to?
We have provided there all the information through from October.
Okay, there is an 8% drop in regular bus ridership and a 22% drop in the trolley. I mean, have we determined what's causing that?
And I'm going to gather some information to present to you all in more granular detail, maybe a sheet of numbers if Commissioner Gerard likes that. But very happy that we are only at 8%. HART is around 11% for the year, and I'll be providing some information comparing. This is a national trend. it's a cycle, but programs like the UPass and our transportation disadvantage program, and the fact that we're a tourist-oriented market and we are somewhat shielded by having a great spring break, spring tourist market, have actually made our ridership do a little bit better when you compare it to our peers. But I've got something coming.
Well, that's just what I wanted to know. Is something coming?
Yeah, yeah. Additionally, last year's numbers were rather high numbers, so we're comparing the percentage change from an all-time high.
And sure. it might be nice if you, when you do present something to us, if you show a couple of years for that very reason. Thank you.
Is Cassandra coming up for service improvements, or was that part of your report?
That was part of the report.
Okay. Sorry. Commissioner Johnson.
I just want to address that one thing, Julia. I have an 18-year-old granddaughter. And she's never been on a bus. She has no intention of getting on a bus. We teach our kids how to do everything, except how to get on a bus and use transportation. We don't teach our kids, it's not in school. I wish the Sierra Club would join us in teaching our future generations that 4 miles to the gallon isn't good, but 4 kids in a car and not on a bus is not good either. I mean, we have to teach this generation and the next generation that we don't have the resources we used to have. I still have horses. That's way back there. But our kids don't know how to use transportation, and that's a shame, and that's on us. That's our fault. So, when kids learn, it'll get full. When I go up north, went to Boston, every kid I saw was using subways, buses, bicycles, every other mode of transportation. It's on us. Okay?
Thank you. I believe our CEO touched on our future meeting subjects. If there's not any other business, I will go ahead and hear board member comments. And this time we'll start to our left and begin with you, Commissioner Wheeler Brown.
No, that's the first. Thank you. I just want to say great meeting, keeping everyone on track. And Brad, thank you for working on providing us information regarding the drop in ridership, because that is something that I've noticed that it's addressed at every meeting, because I think it's important that we understand that it's not only us, but that we understand why it's happening. So thank you for that. And with that is it. Thank you.
Yeah, I thought the meeting was really good as well, and certainly I think the direction we're heading in terms of sustainability on all fronts is really important. And I think it's, as long as we continue to keep mindful that, you know, these aren't 3-year purchases, but they're not 40-year purchases either. And timing may be good now, and it might be better in the next cycle of bus purchases. So I just think we can take leadership roles. We have to be reasonable when we do it, so that we continue to keep in mind the folks that are needing to ride these buses every single day, and our responsibility to them. So again, I just think I thought Commissioner Scott, his comment was right on target in terms of combining the miles per gallon, but also looking at the number of people that we're getting on that bus, and to the marketing efforts that we're doing today, or talking about doing, and the idea to get more riders makes bus riding cheaper by the rider. So, you know, it all kind of works together, and I think that's kind of the direction we're heading. So anyway, thank you. Good meeting.
I just want to build on that. I thought the sustainability discussion was excellent, and I am really pleased with the fact that we have this workshop coming up, and I feel just generally this year like our board is having a better opportunity to think through these issues. As Commissioner Gerard said, prior to the moment where we have to make the decision. So I'm very pleased with that, and I thought it was a great meeting. Thank you.
Commissioner Scott.
Thank you. Just again, great meeting. For the comments that everybody else has had so far, I think it's very good that we're putting the pieces in place to make a very informed decision this summer on bus purchases. So I think that's great. I was my interest kind of piqued with Vice Chair Bajowski's comments earlier about the possible capital revenue share. I don't know if that's really possible for PSK because we have our own capital challenges, but it's still an interesting thing that I'd like to hear a little bit more about. And then lastly, I just to congratulate Mr. Diamond here on his recent announcement for State House. So.
Thank you.
This meeting, no further guests.
I would like to congratulate Mr. Diamond on the same. Excited for him, and thank you for wanting to put your hat in the ring to serve the greater good. It's always a very difficult decision, as all of us know when we've gotten into it, but it is very rewarding. So I hope it works out well for you. I want to just remind everybody I will not be at the workshop because I have a mayor's, Florida League of Mayors has their conference that same day and weekend. So just wanted to let you know I'll be thinking of you, have a good dialogue that day. And then I just wanted to throw out, we haven't had a quarterly meeting with Hart in a while, the executive committee. You know, we usually do that, and it's been about two quarters since that's happened, although I didn't really check. So I just throw that out there.
This summer is coming.
Okay. Great.
And we were up in D.C. with them.
Okay. So you had your own quarterly.
Yeah, I spent a lot of time.
Okay, good. It was good. Well, as long as we're not just walking away from the concept, that's all. All right, thanks.
Thank you. We approved the marketing plan. We talked a little bit about trying to go out and really find out what are the people in our community want from us. And I think that would be a huge benefit to us as we move forward. The other thing that I'm looking forward to is the joint meeting with the, let's see, they have a new name, Forward Pinellas, the old FPO PC, which I think is scheduled for July. But they are moving forward on several initiatives, as we heard from the Vice Mayor, and I believe we need to keep really close to that. Thank you.
Madam Chair and colleagues, great meeting. To Brother Diamond, looking forward to having a transit champion in South Pasadena. Godspeed.
Commissioner Barclay.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair. I was very, very pleased with the marketing report. I think that's just a tremendous chance for us to get the word out on PSTA services and to not only grow our ridership, but get cars off the road and help to attract industry and employers to the area who have overlooked our area because of our transportation network having some shortcomings. I also am very pleased with the successor plan and the employee development component of that, so that we have a way for people to rise through the organization and develop their skills. That's tremendous, and I also like the sustainability plan of how we're moving forward to make sure that PSTA can continue to serve our growing location. Our whole region needs a good transportation network, and we're doing what we can to integrate that into the greater good. So all three of those things are super, and as I say for all you folks on Facebook, Ben Diamond, go get him.
Last and certainly not least, Commissioner Trard.
Well, yeah, as everybody said, great meeting, and just wanted to say to Mr. Diamond, you're already a great public servant. It would be great to see you in elected office too. So
again, a reminder, tomorrow, April 28th at 1 p.m. will be our Largo Transit Center ribbon cutting event on the southeast corner of Roosevelt and 19 next to Walmart. And we'll see you Friday at our informational workshop at 9 a.m. right here in the auditorium, and our next regular board meeting will be May 25th at 9 a.m. And with that, we adjourn our meeting. Thank you.